Clay, I wanted to talk to you about a couple of things. First of all, these companies that are lecturing us, ESPN, the NBA, that are lecturing us about how to live our lives and social justice. And then we find out NBA China, the academies over there, they were horror shows and everybody knew about it.
Yeah, it's in the height of hypocrisy, I think. For people out there who aren't aware, the NBA in particular wants to brand itself as a socially justice-laden league. And they want to convince everybody that if you're not supporting the NBA, you're a horrible human being. And they've put social justice messages on their jerseys. They've put it literally on the court. Nobody is standing for the national anthem. Every single game, it's a triple header there of social justice activism. Yet, simultaneously, they are cashing checks for hundreds of millions or billions of dollars from China in what I'm sure you agree with me is the closest thing to modern Nazism. I know it's a communist-based government, but if you were trying to analogize to modern society, look, they're aggressively taking over Hong Kong. They want Taiwan, the South China Sea, and certainly they're pulling books literally out of libraries. They are fundamentally opposed to basic human rights, the First Amendment, to religious freedom, and they have concentration camps. That sounds very similar to the authoritarianism that we saw from Nazi Germany. And so I think what I'm asking and what many people out there who are reasonably intelligent are asking is, wait a minute, how can you simultaneously lecture America and try to tear down American values while bending the knee to China? You say if we shut up and dribble, it's racist in America. But if China pays you enough money, you'll shut up and dribble about much worse abuses that are going on in their country. And frankly, I think the average American is up to their eyeballs in the hypocrisy and can't stand for it.
So what do you think about the ratings that are just tanking right now? I heard that last time that people were sick of it and the ratings were going down, but it didn't seem to be actually accurate. This time, I just read that NBA and Major League Baseball ratings are in the tank. Is that true? And is this happening because people are sick of it?
Well, so there's a fascinating sort of interplay that's going on right now. So for people who haven't been paying attention, we are dealing with the wildest August of sports that we've ever seen. They start at noon Eastern and go till midnight every day in the NBA, the NHL, Major League Baseball, and golf as well. And the storyline so far has been there's a huge pent-up demand for sports to return, and initially there is a massive blip. We saw it with NASCAR. We saw it with Major League Baseball. We saw it with UFC. We saw it with PGA-related events. NBA didn't go up. In fact, the NBA actually went down a little bit on averages right out of the gates. And since then, the numbers have continued to decline. So whereas every other league in particular saw this massive uptake in interest, the NBA has been trending below their average season interest before they ever shut down at all. For people like
me, why do you think?
What that means, I think it's because of the politics. Look, there are very few people I believe you gain by deciding to be political in the world of sports, by which I mean there are very few people who say, oh, I'm not going to watch this sport because there isn't enough politics mixed in with it, right? There's very few people who say that. Most people, Glenn, they want to get a beer, they want to kick their feet up, and they want to escape the serious things in life. That's why they watch sports, right? They don't want to watch Fox News or MSNBC or CNN or local news or whatever else. They don't want to think about the coronavirus. They want to just have a beer, kick their feet up, and escape the serious things in life. For a very long time, back in the day when everybody bought newspapers, the sports section was called the toy chest of life, right? Like, even as an adult, you'd feel a little bit better as you open the sports page because it's a recitation of men's successes, whereas very often the rest of the newspaper is a recitation of men's failures, right? And so I believe that the people that you are gaining are minuscule to non-existent by being political, and that you're losing a ton. And my argument has been, Glenn, that that's because many people out there think of the average NBA viewer as a 16-year-old on Instagram In reality, the average NBA viewer is a 55-year-old guy in the Midwest, and that guy might well have voted for Donald Trump. You know, there are millions of people, if not tens of millions, that overlap between NBA fans who may be Republican or have voted for Donald Trump. And so when you're telling those people, hey, you're awful human beings, well, why in the world would I want to support your league with my free time when there are a lot of other things that I could choose to do instead?
It's interesting, Clay. I mean, this is the United States of America, and I've always kind of been of the opinion that we're going to put up with a lot of stuff to watch sports. I mean, as an Eagles fan, if Carson Wentz joins ISIS tomorrow, I'm probably still watching.
yeah, right.
But there is a limit, right? And I feel like, just watching the NBA the past few days, I mean, the limit, it's constantly in your face. Every interview is about what they think about the national anthem. It's as if these games mean absolutely nothing, and that is not a way to sell your sport.
Well, here's the larger context. If people say, like, hey, you need to use your platform for to advance better causes and all these different things. What I said on my radio show this morning, and I host the nationwide Fox Sports Radio morning show, was I said, hey, you know, murders are up, according to yesterday's front page Wall Street Journal, 24% in the 50 mm-hmm. largest cities in this country. I think there's a strong argument to be made that the protests in the NBA aren't just alienating viewers. I think you can make an argument that they are making America less safe for the people that they claim that they care about the most, because there are hundreds, if not thousands, of people who are dying in inner cities and in cities in America today because the NBA and other sports leagues have effectively, whether they want to acknowledge it directly or not, decided to demonize law enforcement and make the police the enemy of their league and the enemy of their country, when in reality, we never talk about the tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands of lives that police save every single year in this country. And so when you don't let police do their jobs because you're arguing they're all awful human beings based on the actions of a handful that deserve to be prosecuted, I think you can make an argument that not only is the NBA making it worse for themselves and their own sport, which is at least a business and people can respond to it, I think there's a strong argument that the NBA is actually making things worse in America right now and leading to more deaths than there would be if they had, in fact, just played the games.
So how does this play out? I mean, when you're looking at this, I mean, I think – isn't Drew Brees is still apologizing this morning? He's still behind a microphone apologizing. When you have people just scared out of their wits that they're going to lose everything if they don't abide, how do you get this to be changed? I mean, what happens from here?
I believe in markets, right? I'm a capitalist. I know that sometimes that's a bad word to use in America today.
Not here.
I believe that ultimately pocketbook decisions dictate everything, right? And so what we're doing at OutKick is we're throwing punches back. We're like the only people out there are like, man, I like sports, but I've lost my, you know, sort of ballywick there. You can go read OutKick and you can listen to us, and we're throwing punches back at what we think are bad arguments. But yesterday I had one of my partners at OutKick.com, Jason Whitlock, on with me, who's fantastic. I think the most talented sports writer in America. And he's got a whale of a column that's up on our site today about George Floyd and the challenges that is brought to bear on sports and some of the poor decisions that are being made. But he said, and I think this is true, and I think it's not just true for sports writers, there's a lot of people out there who 100% disagree with the direction that sports are going, even in our sports media industry. But they're like, man, I got a job that pays me $75,000 or $80,000 a year. I got a kid in college. I got a kid that I'm hoping to put in college sometime soon. And it's just not worth me rocking the boat to point out that I disagree when we're in such a universe now where if you have the wrong opinion, you lose your job. So I think what's important is, one, everybody out there listening make their own decision on a day-to-day basis about how they spend their free time based on whether they feel like they are being respected or not, and whether they're getting their dollar of enjoyment out of it or not. But two, I think you need to support people who are throwing punches back so that there becomes more of a marketplace idea in the world of sports. Glenn, I'll give you an example. One of the kids who stood up, when I say kid because he's a young guy, was a guy named last name Isaac, right? He's an Orlando Magic player, very religious, mm-hmm. stood up for the national anthem and gave a great answer right. about why he did so. The next day, unfortunately, he tore his ACL playing for the Orlando Magic. Jonathan Isaac is his name. That same day, ESPN, one of their national radio shows, put up a poll on Twitter. Was it funny that the guy who didn't stand for the national anthem tore his ACL? Well, they would never have done that if Colin Kaepernick had torn his ACL after kneeling. It's become cool in the sports media to ridicule people if they have different political opinions than you deem to be acceptable, and that is basically anything other than far left wing. I think that's alienating a huge portion of the American sporting public, and as a result, we're not having an actual marketplace of ideas. But I think we need to fight back. And I think the great thing about being a capitalist and the great thing about markets is I'm not really a boycott guy, but I am of the belief that if you watch a television show and you ultimately, even if you used to enjoy watching it, if the show is not very good anymore, go find something that's better. If you're a sports fan and you're watching sports and you're like, you know what, I'm not getting as much enjoyment out of this as I used to, go watch something else. Go golf yourself. Go play a sport yourself. And ultimately, when the dollars dry up and when the audience dries up, everybody's going to take a step back and say, man, what were we thinking with the decisions that we made?